Good evening. I welcome all of you for today evening's program, the fifth C.V. Sundaram Memorial Lecture, today to be given by Professor Frederick Asher. It's a great pleasure for me to have Professor Frederick Asher here to give this talk today. I also would like to welcome Professor Catherine Asher, who is here and hopefully will get you to speak here one day in future. It's a pleasure also, as I have had opportunity to work with Professor Asher in some of his recent projects on sites like Nalanda and Sarnath. Today is a very different topic he's speaking about, which we look forward very much to listen. I request our dear director, Dr. Shailesh Nayak, to chair today's session, introduce the series Sundaram Memorial Lecture at NIAS. He was one of our founding members and also today's speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajni, and good evening to everyone. Thank you very much, all of you, to come to this Sundaram Memorial Lecture. As you know that Professor Sundaram was one of the top scientists from the Indira Gandhi Center from Atomic Research, Kalpakkam. And after he superannuated, he joined NIAS, and I think he is the one of the major foundation which was laid by him and some of his colleagues, Dr. Ramanna and all, made the lot of difference. Though he was a metallurgist, but he has a tremendous interest in the history of science and technology, and he did a lot of work. I don't want to go into the details. And to keep his memory alive and the subject on which he has an interest, we instituted this series of lectures, and it's really a pleasure to have Professor Frederick to talk to us about South Asian art. He is a specialist in the South Asian art, and especially in the India's visual culture in the larger context of the Indian Ocean. And this is, I think, is one of the very important aspect, and it came at very right timely, because we have been now thinking about Indian Ocean, the various aspects, the cultural aspects as well as the scientific aspects. And there is a lot of focus now in Indian Ocean globally, for a variety of reasons, because now it has been realized that it is also important part globe which makes the global climate suitable. So it's very good that we need to know, understand about the different aspect, not only the scientific but the cultural aspects as well. Of course, he is a well-known expert on the Buddhist, and his recent book on Buddhist monastery in Nalanda was published in 2015, and he has worked on Sarnath, the site where the Buddha preached his first sermon, which is, I understand, likely to come very shortly. He was also a editor-in-chief for caa.reviews, the electronic journal of College Art Association, and also South Asia editor for Archives of Asian Art. He has various positions in the American Institute of Indian Studies, including treasurer, president, and the board chair. He also served as a president of National Committee for History of Art and the member of Bureau of CIHA. He received a Morse Alumni Distinguished Teaching Award from the University of Minnesota. And in 2015, he was awarded Asian Studies Award from the Association of Asian Studies. His current research examines the visual culture of Indian Ocean trade extending from South China Sea to the East Africa. So we have a very distinguished speaker, and I welcome to this, and I request him to deliver the Sundaram Memorial Lecture. Professor Frederick.
Thank you very much for that generous introduction. It's a pleasure to be thinking about oceans with you, whose work on seismic, the bottoms of oceans. I work on the tops of oceans. So there's a kind of complementarity here. And thank you all for being here, and especially my deep thanks to Rajni, who has been a collaborator and an inspiration. And I have especially had the privilege today of talking to and listening to your students, who are quite spectacular and doing extraordinarily interesting things. Thanks to all of you. Because we're on an IIS campus, broadly speaking, I'll assume that you, my audience, know little about my discipline, so I'd like to say a few words about it and its limitations as widely practiced. I also want to pay respect to the memory of C.V. Sundaram, whose broad-ranging interests, as you were able to see if you paid attention to that PowerPoint, would have made this introduction entirely unnecessary. An extraordinary person. As I think about art history's origins in the 19th century, I think about three prongs. One is archaeology, particularly the work of Heinrich Schliemann and the excavation of the site he identified as Troy, and the work of Johann Winckelmann, whose history of art and antiquity continues to be read today. The second prong is philosophy. Giants in the emerging field of art history, such as Heinrich Wölfflin and Ernst Gombrich, both trained as philosophers, ultimately occupied chairs of art history. And finally, the third prong is science. Yes, science. In 1895, soon after the first professor of art history was appointed, soon after the first professor of art history in America was appointed at Harvard, Elizabeth Fogg endowed a museum to bear her husband's name. It was to serve as a laboratory for students of this new field, art history. But to a very large extent, these broad interests have been abandoned by my field, a matter of serious concern, one that serves as a stimulus for my newest research on the visual culture of Indian Ocean trade. My colleagues in the discipline identify their expertise by geography and chronology. That is, one may be a scholar, for example, of 17th century art in Rome, so narrowly focused that he would know little about art in Venice at that very time. Others might focus on what they call the late 19th century, meaning in their mind only a small geographic region of Western Europe, as if the 19th century bypassed Asia and Africa and South America, an extraordinary concept of time with borders. Thus, for the most part, and I need to stress that there are exceptions, art historians have considerable difficulty talking to one another. That is quite different from, say, physicists and physicians and economists and Rajni's students and all of you at NIAS, who have enough general and theoretical interests that they not only talk to one another, but also collaborate in their research, something art historians rarely do. There are exceptions, of course. Among them, Dr. Setter, for example, certainly one whose mind is by no means confined. It was that concern about my discipline that led me to think about the visual materials of Indian Ocean trade before 1500. Having read Emanuel Wallerstein's Modern World System, which argued that modern capitalism was responsible for creating an interconnected world, and then Janet Abu Lugod's Before European Hegemony, which convincingly argued for an interconnected world long before the rise of modern capitalism and the associated colonialism, I was led to K.N. Chowdhury, a protege of Fernand Braudel, whose work looked at interconnectedness of large areas. In the case of Braudel, areas connected by water, specifically the Mediterranean, and in the case of Chowdhury, a world centered on India. But all those writers are social scientists, and so it seemed to me that the notions could be applied to a humanistic discipline, art history, and to the whole Indian Ocean, an area a great deal more vast than the Mediterranean. In a way, I'm arguing against my own early research work, which focused on Bihar and Bengal from the 6th to the 8th centuries. In completing that work, I realized that my designators were fraught. Modern states, of course, have little bearing on pre-modern India, and the dynastic designators I used so freely in my first book were problematic, at least in part because dynasties didn't rule over territory with fixed borders. And I read rather unproblematically the work of early archaeologists, especially Alexander Cunningham, the founder of the Archaeological Survey of India, who identified sites on the basis of accounts written by the 7th century Chinese pilgrim Xuanzang. In an imperialist fashion, Cunningham and others argued that one had to rely on foreign accounts of India because India had no written historical accounts. That's not true, of course. Then some years later, I came to recognize how faulty that reliance on Xuanzang actually was, both because the Chinese pilgrim wrote his accounts after returning to China from memory, not from notes taken on site, and where distances recorded by Xuanzang didn't match Cunningham's identification of a site, he played with the data, using what worked, offering explanations for data that didn't work. But in retrospect, I've come to have a great deal of respect for Cunningham. His observations of sites were extraordinary. His descriptions fundamentally important for understanding them, and his plans, as Rajani has helped me realize, remain extremely helpful resources. And more to the point, it was the Chinese pilgrims who helped me think beyond India, to think about India's pre-modern links with the rest of the world. On May 18, 1964, the Calcutta newspaper, The Statesman, announced the discovery of a 5-foot statue at a village in North Malaya, stating that the statue was identified as, quote, a relic from a Pallava temple dedicated to Lord Shiva. That announcement stimulated a parliamentary question, one frankly rather trivial considering the role of Parliament in governing the nation. But then, a lot of parliamentary questions are trivial and consume all too much time of the various ministries. So as a result, the High Commission of Malaya was asked for more information. With less than lightning speed, the High Commission responded about 2 years later, on 22nd February, 1966, noting that the statue had been found in Pengkalang Bujang in the Malay state of Kedah. They enclosed a photo, a grainy one, barely in focus, of a pretty abraded sculpture. I can find no parliamentary record responding to this information, not even a thank you. And the photograph certainly doesn't allow me to say whether it is a Pallava sculpture, a term that other, like other dynastic designators, for works of Indian art, needs to be interrogated. So too does the role of India more generally, or Indians more specifically, in the adoption of Indian languages and religions and religious imagery in Southeast Asia. Certainly by the first century, Indians did travel abroad in violation of the injunction in the Manusmriti and other texts by going to sea, as if mercantile avarice trumped, pardon the expression, Brahmanical prohibition. To a large extent, however, the evidence shows Indians from Western Indian ports traveling westward, presumably toward Roman Egypt or the Italian peninsula. The strongest evidence comes from the 193 Indian inscriptions in the Hope Cave on Socotra Island. These brief inscriptions are written in Brahmi script and record the names that are distinctly Indian, sometimes giving the name of the writer's father. A few inscriptions give an indication of religion, and others specify the writer's role, most commonly ship's captain or helmsman, that is, Navika or Niryamaka. And a very few provide places of origin, usually seaports, corresponding to modern Brach and Hattab, that is, on either side of the Gulf of Cambay in Gujarat. But based on the style of script, that is, paleography, it's clear that by the 5th century, no more inscriptions were written, as if this route from Gujarat westward ceased to be important, probably taken over by the Sasanians. Other inscriptions, though, often taken as evidence of Indian sailing around the first century, do not necessarily provide evidence of travel by Indians. These are very brief inscriptions on potsherds written in Brahmi script, and often more specifically described as Tamil Brahmi, though I see no need to be so precise. One comes from Korhrori in southern Oman, another from Berenike in Egypt, three from Kaiser al-Kadim in Egypt, and a third from Phukaw Thong north of Bangkok. The only very early evidence for Indian trade with Southeast Asia, besides some carnelian beads whose origin is not certain. Despite Indian newspapers proclaiming that these inscriptions show evidence of, and I'll quote, Tamil trade ships that sailed to foreign shores, as the Times of India heralded, I am neither persuaded that the script originates from Tamil Nadu. The inscriptions are just too brief to determine that. Nor do I think that they show evidence that Indians traveled for trade to these places. The shards were part of ceramic vessels used for transporting goods, which could have been carried by ships from just about anywhere, with a crew also from just about anywhere. And there were a few early sculptural objects from India found west of the subcontinent, but not to the east, that is, not in Southeast Asia. These include a tiny ivory figurine from Pompeii that must date before the eruption of Mount Vesuvius in 79 of the Common Era, and a small bronze figure from Korhrori in Oman, the site that yielded the brief Brahmi inscription on a potsherd. The old photograph I have to use because no one seems able to find this Korhrori bronze. But again, I don't take these as evidence of Indians abroad, but rather as evidence of the taste for Indian things besides silk and pepper and other food products, even though Sorena Otiero, an archaeologist who's worked at Korori, believes that at least the bronze figurine was an Indian trader's personal property. And reciprocally, evidence for trade with Rome comes from Roman-style ceramic vessels that have been found on both the west coast of India, for example, at Pattanam in Kerala, and on the east coast at Arikamedu in Tamil Nadu and Tamluk in West Bengal. But after about the second century, evidence for India's trade with the West diminishes, either because the Roman world looked elsewhere for luxury goods, or because the Sasanians dominated trade routes with the West. Of these ports, Tamralipta, probably identifiable with modern Tamluk in West Bengal, was the one that persisted most vibrantly beyond the second century, at least through the 7th century. I think there may have been two factors that allowed it to survive. One may have been the Eastern Indian location, a location shielded from Sasanian competition, though Arikamedu too was on India's east coast. But the other, maybe more important factor, was the presence of a Buddhist community there. And I see Buddhists, like Jains, as central to the overseas mercantile enterprise. The Buddhist presence at Tamralipta is documented by the 5th century Chinese pilgrim Faxian, who spent 2 years at a monastery there before sailing from the port to Sri Lanka, and the 7th century pilgrim Yi Jing, who sailed eastward from the port to Sri Vijaya, probably modern Sumatra, and comments that others sail from Tamralipta to Sri Lanka. Even though I don't think Tamralipta flourished much after the time of Yi Jing, the presence of a Buddhist community there may be one clue to its importance as a port. Buddhists were in no way bound by caste hierarchies that put merchants and mercantile activities low on a social ladder. The parallel in Western India may have been the strong Jain presence. Nonetheless, Tamralipta doesn't seem to have had much of a life as a port after the 7th century. My guess is that after Yi Jing's departure from the port, the Rup Narayan River, which likely served as an important trade conduit between the interior and Tamralipta, silted up, diminishing the importance of Tamralipta as a trading port. The 7th century Gauda monarch, Shashanka, probably didn't help much either. His persecution of Buddhists may well have disrupted the port. And about that very time, South India appears to have emerged as the premier focus for maritime trade, yet another reason for the eclipse of Tamralipta. Around the 6th or 7th century, I see a coincidence of three things that seem to happen almost simultaneously. First, the establishment of what Sheldon Pollock calls a Sanskrit cosmopolis, that is, the use of Sanskrit as the language for inscriptions not only in India, but widely across Southeast Asia. Second, the beginnings of Buddhist, Shaiva, and Vaishnava imagery across Southeast Asia, imagery that is stylistically and iconographically modeled on Indian works, especially intriguing to me in the absence of earlier figural sculpture in any medium in Southeast Asia. And third, Robert Brown's observation that bronze images cast in the lost wax technique, as opposed to the piece mold cast objects such as bells and mirrors begin to be made both in India and Southeast Asia. I cannot demonstrate that these three things are interrelated, not coincidental, although I do think they are related to one another, but that's just a hunch for now. Nor can I demonstrate conclusively the means by which these three things were transported from India to Southeast Asia. But art historians, like other humanists, sometimes have to fabricate a story, which then can serve as a model to be tested. That's different, I know, from the evidence-based research that most of you conduct. But understand, please, the evidence we have, especially when dealing with events that took place more than 1,000 years ago, is scant and largely the result of a process, not evidence for the process itself. Let me start with the widespread use of Sanskrit for religious and legal texts. As Pollock says, and I quote, "Sanskrit became the premier instrument of political expression in the polities of most of South and Southeast Asia." I will add then that there are holes in this cosmopolis, for example, Burma and Sri Lanka, where Sanskrit was not used to articulate political authority. For the use of Sanskrit elsewhere in South and Southeast Asia, the evidence is largely inscriptions on stone, such as this one, from somewhere in the Kedah region of Malaysia. Even though parts of this inscription are hard to read, enough is legible that we can tell that it records a Buddhist verse beginning, "Ye Dharma Hetu," a verse that some of you may know in complete form. A second inscription on the slab, this very slab, refers to the Mahanavika Buddhagupta, that is, the great sailor Buddhagupta. Then comes the word Rakta Murtika Vasa, that is, a resident of Rakta Murtika, followed by what appears to be a wish for a successful voyage. The slab and its inscription is generally assigned to the 5th century, perhaps somewhat too early. The assumption, because the language is Sanskrit and the script is Brahmi, is that Buddhagupta was an Indian, and so the quest generally is to identify Raktamurtika. Often it is assumed to be the site of the Buddhist monastery excavated at Rajbadidanga in West Bengal, where a seal identifies the place as Raktamurtika, a name meaning red clay, so probably shared by several places. But we must recognize that about this time, the 5th century and later, in both northern Malaysia and Thailand, as well as parts of present-day Indonesia and Cambodia, Sanskritic names for both places and individuals were widely used. So while I think it likely that Buddhagupta was an Indian sailor who had traveled to the Kedah region of Malaysia, I cannot say so without hesitation. And I should note that several inscribed slabs very similar to the Buddhagupta one were also found in the Kedah region. For example, this one from Kampung Sungai Mas, also in northern Malaysia. Unlike the Buddhagupta slab, however, all of the others bear only Buddhist formulaic inscriptions. Whatever their purpose, and whatever the origin of the individuals who provided these slabs, they do indicate a Buddhist presence in this part of Malaysia, and thus a connection to India. Although these Sanskrit inscriptions from Kedah, like those from other parts of Southeast Asia, are undated, They are generally given dates about the 5th century, a date based on only the style of writing of the inscriptions. But the style of writing can be notoriously difficult to date, and Brahmi inscriptions, distant from India, can appear older than they really are. A couple of Sanskrit inscriptions from Southeast Asia are often assigned a date even earlier than the 5th century, though there are compelling arguments against such dates. For example, the inscribed stone slab found at Vo Chan, about 4 kilometers from the Vietnamese coastal city of Nha Trang, is often dated as early as 300 of the Common Era. It refers to the great-granddaughter of a king named Sri Mara. And Sanskrit inscriptions on seven sacrificial posts found in the Kutai region of Indonesia's East Borneo are often dated about 400. Referring to the sacrifice of someone with the distinctly Sanskritic name, Mulavarman, they too are dated paleographically, that is, by the style of letters forming the inscription, not by any evidence drawn from the inscription's content. I would doubt that any of these inscriptions dates before the middle of the 5th century, and more likely from the 6th century. The earliest dated inscriptions from Southeast Asia were found in Cambodia, namely the Bayang Temple inscription dated by chronogram to the year of the Shaka era, 526, that is equivalent to 604 of the Common Era, and the Angkor Boré inscription of Shaka 533, dated equivalent to 611 of the Common Era, both written in perfectly composed Sanskrit. The use of Shaka era dates is especially significant, as we'll see. In Indonesia, the earliest dated inscription is from Kedoan Bukit on coastal Sumatra. And it too uses the Shaka era, that is Shaka 605, equivalent to 683 of the Common Era. This inscription, which mixes Sanskrit and Old Malay, records a military expedition undertaken in some 200 dugout boats. And the oldest dated inscription in Thailand is from Noan Sabua. It's dated Shaka 683, equivalent to 761 of the Common Era. It's a Buddhist inscription, but written in Khmer, despite its Shaka era date, with 3 long verses in Pali. No part of the inscription is written in Sanskrit, although Sanskrit was widely used in Thai inscriptions, for example, the so-called Ligor inscription from Chaya in the southernmost part of Thailand, dated Shaka 697, that is 775 of the Common Era. Note again that all these inscriptions use Shaka era to record the dates. Whatever their dates, these inscriptions demonstrate that a language, a highly complex one as Sanskrit is, was adopted with all its nuances in diverse parts of Southeast Asia. There was no political or military expansion that can account for this. The situation, as Sheldon Pollock notes, is very different from the spread of Latin across Europe, where a Roman military may not have imposed the language, but at least made it the language of the conqueror's discourse. That was not the case in Southeast Asia, where vernaculars prevailed as the languages of everyday discourse and must have been used even by foreign traders in Southeast Asian ports. So the question has to be, How did Sanskrit come to trump local languages in the proclamation of religious and legal documents? And to that I might add, how did the practice of writing on stone, one that in India can be seen as early as the 3rd century BCE, come to be the mode of document preservation distant from India, that is, in Southeast Asia? One explanation sometimes put forward for the change is the role of the Gupta dynasty, which ruled from 320 to 550. George Shiddis, for example, observed that the earliest impact of an Indian political group on Southeast Asia was the Guptas, beginning in the 4th century. Monica Smith then amplified this, suggesting that the Gupta dynasty, which she describes as, quote, the first long-lived political organization in the Indian subcontinent, offered Southeast Asia, in her words, a coherent model of political, social, and religious integration resulting from political consolidations in the subcontinent. The notion of a large, powerful ruling house, essentially ruling from the Arabian Sea to the Bay of Bengal, is tinged with a modern sense of nationalism. The Guptas were avowedly Vaishnava. Some scholars, such as Giovanni Verardi, even see the Gupta dynasty as fostering persecution of Buddhists. And then there's the Allahabad pillar inscription. In this inscription, Samudragupta, who ruled from about 350 to 375, claims conquest of a great deal of India, all the way south to Kanchi, north to Nepal, east to modern-day Bangladesh and Assam. In this time of Trump, however, we need to question bold claims and at least recognize that a circuit through all that territory doesn't mean that he ruled it. But let's say, for the sake of argument, that he ruled all that territory. That was the 4th century, and it's quite clear that his Gupta successors ruled far less territory. But I think we need to back away from the notion of an Indian imperial power having control over trade and the export of language, religion, and imagery. I will argue that merchants, not monarchs, controlled trade. The second thing that seems to have happened about the 6th century is the production of Buddhist, Shaiva, and Vaishnava imagery across Southeast Asia. What strikes me as especially intriguing is not only that this imagery appears almost simultaneously across an enormous area, Thailand, Malaysia, Cambodia, Java, and Sumatra, but that it appears in the absence of earlier figural traditions in the region, a situation not unlike that of inscriptions. Just to cite a couple of examples, I might note that this Vishnu image from Angkor Boré in Cambodia and generally ascribed to the 6th century, or this standing Buddha in the Cleveland Museum of Art from an unspecified site in Thailand that is assigned to the end of the 6th century. Both works, like many others in Southeast Asia at this time, were fashioned in distinctively regional styles, but styles whose precedents are hard to identify. They almost seem to appear fully realized. So the obvious question is, how did the imagery for religions that were entirely new to Southeast Asia develop? Were there models that local artists could adapt? I think the answer is yes. But first I need to think aloud about how Buddhism, Vaishnavism, and Shaivism came to be adopted in Southeast Asia, And to do so, we need to see how trade was conducted in the 6th century and the centuries immediately following it. Philip Curtin, an Africa specialist, suggests that trade was conducted in pre-modern times through what he calls entrepôts, that is, small foreign trading communities. For example, an Arab entrepôt settled in Zanzibar, which would serve as an intermediary between arriving Arab ships and local Zanzibari merchants. That entrepot would likely be bilingual. They would know the proper value of goods brought by Arab ships and the value of goods that merchants sending these ships might want to buy from Zanzibar. The members of the entrepot community also would know local customs and taxation, and so could help their countrymen arriving on merchant ships get the most favorable deals, sometimes even exclusive trading rights. While I cannot prove that there were Indian entrepôts in Southeast Asia in the 6th century, I have to assume that there were. And we know that not much later, there were Indian mercantile communities settled there as well as in southern China. How these communities functioned isn't specified in any written source, but I think Curtin's examples provide a good model for thinking about how an expatriate mercantile community of Indians abroad might have functioned. These merchants, I assume, brought with them more than business acumen. They brought ways of life that were based on their community and their faith. And in many ways, I think that would have been very attractive to both merchants and rulers in Southeast Asia. That is, these Indian merchants doubtless had written records and an accounting system. Quite unlike Brahmins who relied on memorized texts, these merchants needed to keep written records of debt and the value of things. To their Southeast Asian trading partners, and to the rulers who imposed taxes and authorized trading rights, that must have seemed very attractive, since they lacked a written version of their language and the numerical notation that might be used for accounting. So it seems reasonable to suggest that a monarch might adopt not only the practice of written accounts, but also the culture that goes with that practice. And if a ruler adopts it, then his subjects likely found compelling reason to do so. All this is what I imagine to have happened. I don't have evidence that it did, but I can cite evidence of merchants settled on foreign soil. For example, some of you may have read Amitav Ghosh's account of a Jewish merchant from Aden, Abraham ben Yiju, settled on the Kerala coast, an account based on documents in the Cairo Geniza. And evidence of a diaspora entrepot, as opposed to the lone trader ben Yiju, comes from an inscription at a site known as Phra Narai in the Takuapa district of southern Thailand, a site whose location is wildly misidentified, I suppose because most of those who write about it have never been there. The inscription, in Tamil, by the way, the inscription records the excavation of a tank during the reign of a monarch who has been identified as the 9th century Pallava king Nandivarman III. This tank, the inscription says, was put under the protection of a merchant guild, presumably an Indian merchant guild resident there. Also from the site, and an important clue to the sources for Southeast Asian images, is this over life-size figure of Vishnu, probably dated datable to the 9th century, and almost surely either an import from South India or made by an artist who was brought to this place to serve the needs of the Indian merchant community. It may be easily compared to Chola figures from Tamil Nadu, or even to figures of about the 8th or 9th century from Karnataka, for example, those from Pattadakal and other places. The stone of this figure and a pair of accompanying images that you see here flanking it in situ needs to be examined petrographically to determine its source. That is, could it have been quarried locally or imported from India? Whatever the origin of this figure, it suggests that Indian merchants settled abroad felt the need to be accompanied by their deities, ones whose transcendent form was manifest in material imagery. That was certainly the case in southern China, where both written records and material remains verify the presence of an Indian diaspora trade community resident there. For example, the 8th century Chinese priest, Jian Shen, is quoted as observing three Indian monasteries populated by what he calls Brahmins. Later, in the 13th century, the Venetian traveler Marco Polo, if his account is in any way accurate, observed a great many Indian ships in the port at Xuanzhou, which he called Zetong. The presence of an Indian community in Xuanzhou is confirmed by many sculptures that are clearly from at least one Hindu temple and made in a style very close to that of late Chola dynasty works, though probably made locally, not imported from India. Generally, they are associated with a Tamil inscription dated 1281, found right here at Xuanzhou. But that inscription refers to the provision of a Shiva temple, and I see the majority of Xuanzhou sculptures as Vaishnava. Nonetheless, they do seem to me datable on the basis of style to the 13th century. And so there may have been two temples at Xuanzhou, a Shaiva one and a Vaishnava one. What I'm suggesting then is that Indian diaspora trading communities brought with them the paraphernalia of religion, which at the very least was sculptural images, probably also priests to officiate, and sometimes even temples very closely related to temples from home, much as the diaspora today often imports Indian architects, jet-setting stapatis, as I call them, and sculptors to design the and elaborate their temples abroad. And images probably brought by Indian merchants, I think, served as both the stimulus and models for the beginnings of Buddhist, Vaishnava, and Shaiva imagery in Southeast Asia. The images they brought were small, often cast in bronze. They were probably brought as personal images not intended for a temple, but rather for individual worship. For example, I might start with a small stone Buddha image from Thailand. Many see this figure as a Gupta period image from Sarnath. I don't. That is, if we relate it to the actual style of 5th century images at Sarnath, such as this one on the right, the Thai figure lacks the subtlety of Gupta works. And so I see it as dating later than the 5th century. I think this and two other figures, let's call them, a bronze standing Buddha found at Pathomchedi, about 50 kilometers west of Bangkok, and another standing bronze Buddha found at Chundipendiat, again in the Kedah region of Malaysia, both likely produced somewhere in South India, underscore my sense that merchants carried images that could have served as models for local production in this part of Southeast Asia. The stone figure is only 16 centimeters high, and the two bronze figures are even somewhat smaller. These images were the sort of images carried by Indian merchants who formed the trade diasporas in Southeast Asia. They were, I would guess, personal images, intended for private worship, not for enshrinement in a temple or other more public space. And small though they were, they could have served as models for much larger figures carved locally, beginning about the 7th century. The reason I suggest these images were used for personal worship is because that was the function of the small bronze images from Indian sites. Just to cite one example, at Nalanda, certainly the most important Buddhist monastic site from the 5th century to at least the 9th century, every bronze sculpture was found in one of the monastic dwellings, not in any of the temples. I think bronze, at least to some extent, made possible the transport of images by individual merchants, as well as by Chinese and Southeast Asian pilgrims returning from the homeland of Buddhism. Bronzes, especially those that are hollow cast, are generally lighter than their stone counterparts. And for the most part, these bronze images are relatively small and portable. Bronze is the third strand that I want to factor into the transformations of about the 6th century. While a few Gupta period bronzes made in India can be identified, mostly preserved in Tibetan monasteries or kept by Tibetans seeking refuge in India, and thus testimony to their portability, the use of copper in Gupta India is well attested by copper plate inscriptions on rectangular sheets of copper bound together by a ring, much as palm leaf manuscripts are bound by cloth ties. In fact, the plates are referred to in the inscriptions as patta, the very word for leaf. But I should note that not one of these inscriptions is a royal edict, not one of these Gupta inscriptions is a royal edict, even though they note the date in the Gupta era. They are all legal documents pertaining to land, as if transferring to permanent material, copper, a document that was initially inscribed on more ephemeral material. In the South, the early copperplate inscriptions, though all regarding land tenure or land transfer as well, do have royal imprimatur. That is, they are invariably executed with the authority of the royal family. For example, the Mayadavulu plates, probably the earliest Pallava copperplate inscriptions, issued by the Yuva Maharaja, that is, the heir apparent. As Vidya Dahija has noted, however, quote, there is no copper at all that may be profitably mined in the granitic region of Chola territory, that is, in modern Tamil Nadu. What then was the source for copper? Dahija further suggests that Sri Lanka, specifically, the Seruwila copper belt might have been the source of copper used at least in Chola times. And just 2 days ago, really, literally 2 days ago, your colleague, Sharada Srinivasan, suggested in an email that Kalyadi in Karnataka might be the source. One other possible source, however, might have been present Thailand or western Sumatra, as suggested by large copper ingots, weighing as much as 4.6 kilos, found in one shipwreck possibly intended for Indian ports. If copper from Southeast Asia was headed to India in this ship, the purchase of ingots was probably negotiated by an Indian expatriate community resident at the ports in Southeast Asia. And these expatriate communities may provide a clue to the dating system used in the Sanskrit inscriptions from Southeast Asia. Although every Pallava and Chola dynasty inscription, that is, the inscriptions from present-day Tamil Nadu, is dated according to the regnal year of the reigning monarch, a continuous era, that is, the Shaka era, is almost universally used in Southeast Asian Sanskrit inscriptions, even those in Tamil. This has led Sheldon Pollock to suggest that the source might be Karnataka, where inscriptions are often dated in the Shaka era, a notion proposed still earlier by S. Nagaraju, who based his conclusion on the paleography of the inscriptions. Let me suggest another explanation. I would suggest that we need to think about two sorts of inscriptions in Southeast Asia: those issued by government officials in the region and those issued written by Indian communities abroad. The official records of gifts of images and land and slaves to temples such as those made by the Cambodian monarch Buvavarman in Shaka 561, that is 639 of the Common Era, and the inscription from Sumatra dated Shaka 608, that is 686 of the Common Era, threatening a curse to those who failed to follow the dictates of the Srivijaya king on one hand, might be recognized as those issued by government officials. While on the other hand, there are those written by Indian communities abroad, such as the Takuapa and Xuanzhou inscriptions. Those that represent official proclamations by government officials indicate the extent to which Indian languages and often Indian religions, as well as Indian names for both places and individuals, were adopted across Southeast Asia. The other suggests the process by which those things were transmitted, that is, Indian merchant communities. What is curious is that both types of inscriptions use the Shaka era to record dates. But how did the Shaka era come to be the calendral system used outside of India? In present-day Tamil Nadu, all royal inscriptions use regnal years, not Shaka era, to denote dates, as do inscriptions of pre-modern merchant guilds in Tamil Nadu. There is only one exception I know, an inscription of a merchant guild on a temple at Krishnapatnam in Nellore district dated Shaka 1201, but it also provides the date in terms of the monarch's regnal year. So might Shelley Pollock be right in suggesting that the use of Shaka era across Southeast Asia and at Xuanzhou in China can be traced to present-day Karnataka, where inscriptions, both those issued by royalty and those of merchant communities, use Shaka era? The problem is that there is not a single Kannada language inscription that I know anywhere in Southeast Asia, although at least seven Tamil inscriptions are known. I thought about Sri Lanka as a possible source, since there are a few Pali language inscriptions in the region that comprises modern Thailand. But Sri Lankan inscriptions, like those of Tamil Nadu, record the dates in regnal years, not in any continuous era. Nonetheless, I don't want to rule out the impact Sri Lankan imagery, if not Sri Lankan written records, had on Southeast Asia. several images, for example, this one from Palembang in coastal Sumatra, and the other from Sulawesi, both reveal close stylistic connections with sculpture of Sri Lanka, apparent in this comparison. So how to explain this? There really seem to me, in conclusion, only two possibilities. One is a proposal I'll make in a few minutes. The other is to accept Pollock's proposal that Karnataka was the source. So let's examine his argument, one based on the epigraphic record. In his words, quote, though the assumption of a Pallava source for Southeast Asian, for the Southeast Asian adoption of Sanskrit is reasonable geographically, it is made doubtful by the dating, style, literary form, and paleography of the Southeast Asian Sanskrit records. From the start, records were dated in the Shaka era, a calendrical convention never once met among the Pallavas, whose records use exclusively regnal years. It is among the Chalukyas of Badami that the oldest tradition of Shaka era dating is found. Formally, many early Southeast Asian texts typically include verse, as do Chalukya records. The Pallavas never use verse. Paleography, too, makes it easy to connect Southeast Asian inscriptions with the Chalukyas as with the Pallavas. Even though Nagaraju had suggested Karnataka as a source for the inscriptions, some 24 years before Pollock wrote, Pollock's argument is especially compelling because he bases his conclusion on more than just paleography. Without doubt, language, together with its accoutrements, is the carrier of culture. But we must remember, humans are the carrier of language. So my question is, which humans? Let's start with the ports in the territory ruled by the Chalukyas. Travel around the southern tip of India to Southeast Asia is longer, but not impossible. Roman ships, or at least ships bearing Roman goods, reach East Coast ports such as Arikamedu. And in the 6th century, the Greek merchant Cosimos in Decapolis made several trips to India, at least he says he did, and notes at least three ports that many believe fell within the Chalukya realm: Kalyana, Mangaruth, and Malay. But there isn't at least yet, the archaeological evidence to link these ports with overseas trade. Moreover, I continue to be bothered by the total absence of Kannada inscriptions anywhere in Southeast Asia. So that leaves me with a proposal, at least as a working hypothesis. Namely, that the Indian merchants abroad, even those from Tamil Nadu, used Shaka era for the notation of time in their accounts and other business records. For merchants, a continuous era must have seemed more efficient as a way of recording, accounts. It was in no way reliant on changes in royal hegemony, especially when Indian merchants were distant from India and news of royal succession would have traveled slowly. And to reiterate, these very merchants were almost surely the source of inspiration for the sculptural images produced by or for those in Southeast Asia who had adopted Indian religions. Not only were the small portable images a source of inspiration, but I imagine that the merchants also carried drawings of deities, perhaps on cloth, perhaps on palm leaf manuscripts. Almost a century ago, Ananda Kumaraswamy suggested that the flattened form of the Xuanzhou reliefs result from Chinese artists working from drawings carried by the Indian merchant community there, a notion that might be extended to the early Buddhist and Brahmanical sculptures of much of Southeast Asia, which invariably show a rather planar form and linear outline. As we see, for example, in this early Thai Buddha figure, it is not at all surprising to me that the earliest surviving manuscripts in India are Buddhist and Jain, both communities that have strong mercantile affiliation. And a great many of these books are illustrated. What we lack are books produced before the 11th century. But as the astronomer Carl Sagan said about the possibility of extraterrestrial life, the absence of evidence isn't evidence for absence. And finally, books would help explain the complex iconographic culture, parallel to but not necessarily integrated with the Sanskrit cosmopolis, one in which detailed iconography of a vast array of Buddhist and Brahmanical deities was shared across the Indian Ocean. My sense in the end is that the transmittal of artistic styles may be even more complex than the transmittal of Sanskrit from India to Southeast Asia. Perhaps we should not think of a single source. After all, the exchanges between India and Southeast Asia were maintained over an enormously long time and covered thousands of coastal kilometers. We should not assume a continued and unvaried trade system during the course of more than a millennium. Ports became silted or commercially inconsequential, and new ones opened. Mercantile communities and royal houses that oversaw trade flourished and declined, thus altering patterns of trade, even the very goods that were traded. And finally, I think the distinction between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka as a source for written documentation and religious imagery in Southeast Asia may be overstated. I'm not at all sure we should think of dynasties and their accoutrements, including architects, sculptors, and scribes, as discrete and unchanging entities. We know, for example, that the Chalukyas took an architect and a couple of princesses when they defeated the Pallavas. It would not be hard to imagine taking scribes as well, much as the Pallavas probably did when they, somewhat earlier, defeated the Chalukyas. Scribes, we may imagine, were an enormously valuable resource. And so we need to think not just of the movement of merchants, but also the movement of all those who might have been in their employ, including trusted scribes. Thank you.
I'm not an art historian, but I want to narrate an observation and then ask a question. As a tourist, we visited Vietnam a few years back, and one of the places we visited was Da Nang, you know, the deep sea harbor in the middle of Vietnam. There was a new museum that was there, and it was full of stone sculpture of many Hindu deities. But the features were Khmer, they were not Indian. So it looks as if they were done by local artists. And they looked very old, but we had no way of telling. There were a lot of books there, and there were different dates there, and some of the dates were very old. And I was quite surprised to see so many Hindu deities figures. You know, it was, something like half of this hall full of these statues. So do you have any comment?
At all surprised with that, because had you gone up to Da Nang, where you would have seen a museum, which is, what, three or four times the size of this hall, it is filled with Hindu divinities, images of Hindu divinities, made, however, in a distinctively local Kham style. So too, however, the temples in Vietnam at My Son, brick temples, are Hindu temples. So the real issue to me is, how do we get from the Indian iconography, the iconography that was developed here, primarily on, developed in South India primarily, transmitted to Vietnam? And my guess, as I tried to indicate, is that it came either from very small sculptures, though the ones that survive that we have are Buddhist, not Brahmanical, or from drawings. We know that drawings were made in fairly large numbers, sometimes by pilgrims. When Xuanzang, no, I'm sorry, when Fa Xian left India, and Yi Jing as well, they took with them large numbers of drawings that they had made of India, of Buddhist imagery. What was the material they were on? We don't know. I would guess that they would be on cloth of some sort rather than on palm leaf, which would be a little too small to replicate. But those then could serve as, at the very least, the iconographic model. And so the rather flattened form, I would imagine, of the images that you saw in Vietnam, and certainly the ones in Da Nang, are at the museum there, result from a translation of a style, of a drawn style to a three-dimensional one.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for keeping us enthralled.
Pleasure.
Did I miss mention of people going from Cuttack area of Odisha? Because they had a very long tradition of maritime trade, and even now they have this celebration called Bali Yatra.
Sure.
So I perhaps missed that in your lesson.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I did not mention Orisha, Odisha. I'm going to learn to deal with the change of names, that hard though it is. And I wouldn't rule it out at all. The correlations between some of the sculptures at that I see at Lalitagiri, and especially at Ratnagiri, and those from Southeast Asia are strong. Nonetheless, as with Tamil Nadu, there is no Orissan, no Oriya inscription anywhere in Southeast Asia. I guess I might add one other thing, though I'm thinking aloud now. I don't think there's evidence, but I may be wrong, of the merchant guilds that we have both in Karnataka and in Tamil Nadu. I don't think there's evidence of Orissan merchant guilds comparable to the large, powerful, and very wealthy ones from Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. And that may make Orissa, Odisha, less likely a major player in the trade. May. I don't know. And it's not something I've yet explored, but it needs to be explored, examined, and examined critically.
Professor Asher, this is a wonderful lecture. I enjoyed listening to you. Now history has become so important. We are at a historical turning point. India wants to write its own history now. As you know, a lot of effort is made and so on. And your lecture brought it out very clearly, the artistic pieces from Asia in particular, how they have gone around the world and influenced and trade. In fact, this China and India has been even more finally sealed at Mahabalipuram, where the Prime Minister of China and Prime Minister of India met and signed Guangzhou and so on. And in fact, lecture time was so limited at one level, You couldn't cover Korea and Japan, Nara, where all this went, trade has gone. But there is a very sensitive question that is arising. These objects are now, from history, by archaeology, they've been discovered, if you like, and put in museums. But which museums? There are museums across the world. And there is a big question about repatriating them to the place where they were found. This is a very sensitive question, and I would like to have your view on this, because partly as the value of this is brought out even more by lectures like yours, the object desire, they become objects of desire. People want to take them by hook or crook, take them away and so on. These are very difficult problems. And if you may remember, Vijay Kumar from Singapore has done a lot to trace these and so on. What is your view? In fact, it's very interesting that first time in the Metropolitan Museum, there is an Indian on board. This is Mrs. Ambani, has recently been inducted, because everybody wants to make sure of their position. One way to make sure that the Indian objects don't go back is to have an Indian on board there and so on. I'm sorry to ask you this sensitive topic, but this occupies, and perhaps Professor Setter may also like to say what his views are on this. Thank you.
Sure. It is something about which I feel very, very strongly. I talked today about earlier today with some of with Rajani and some of her students about what I would treat as illegal excavations at, in the surrounding area of Sarnath. Now, I only speculate that they were that the sculptures we see in American museums that are almost surely from Sarnath came from illegal excavations of the mounds that are outside of the Archaeological Survey of India's excavated area. And I say that because every one of those sculptures was acquired in a very short five-year period, 1931 to 1936. I have two sort of somewhat conflicting points of view. I do think there is something to be said for an encyclopedic museum such as the British Museum, the Louvre, or the Metropolitan Museum. At the same time, however, I feel very strongly that works that have been collected since 1970, the date of the UNESCO Convention on the transportation and importation of works of art, have no place whatever in any museum. And I have argued, at least locally, that, for example, a Greek sculpture that the Minneapolis Institute of Art acquired from a Swiss dealer, which is always very suspect, it seems to me, should not have been acquired. I'm not saying it should never have been acquired in the first place. That is an absurdity and an annoyance. Okay, so how to deal with all of the other many, many works that are abroad? I first of all would like very much to see, before I say this, your reference to Singapore, the National The Asian Civilizations Museum has been pretty good. They have set in motion the return of an extraordinarily important Kushan work that they never should have acquired in the first place, but did acquire long after 1970. It's an inscribed, dated, seated figure of the Buddha. It's a magnificent piece, and it belongs here in India from whence it came. And they have made arrangements with the survey to return it. Okay, I also think that some of the illicit trade that has resulted in all of these images comes from those who are circumventing Indian law and could be perhaps ameliorated if India would make available for international purchase, or for that matter, purchase within India, works of art that sit languishing, never on view in Indian museums and the duplicate works they already have. My case in point might be the dozens and dozens and dozens of Pala period Vishnu images that lie in, or stand in storage in the Indian Museum. In a storage, by the way, that every monsoon is flooded and the works sadly damaged. You can see the flood lines on the knees of many of these figures. If the government of India would make those available either as long-term loans or even for sale, I think that would reduce the illicit trade, much as I feel, by the way, that other illicit activities, drugs, prostitution, should be made legal so that it can be controlled. And I have that same feeling, strong feeling, about works of art. Now, I've avoided saying anything about returning works, but I think if the works have a known provenance, which can be demonstrated, they should be returned. And let me, at the risk of boring everybody, give you a case in point in which I was somewhat instrumental in getting some a work returned to India. The 1971 fiscal report, you know, financial report, something that almost nobody ever reads, from the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, was decorated, so to speak, with a picture of an Indian bronze on the cover. And I recognized that bronze, and so the label that said from Eastern India, I knew, was not entirely correct. It could have been more specific. So I wrote the curator of Indian art, Jan Fontaine, a note. We didn't have email in those days, to say, you know, you can be much more specific. I know that it is from Bengal. It's the style of Bengal. And then I thought about it more and more and more, and I remembered where I'd seen it published, in R.D. Banerjee's Eastern Indian School of Medieval Sculpture, where it was published as being from the site of Sagardighi in Murshidabad district, West Bengal. And so I wrote Jan Fontaine once again, and he wrote me back a note that said, thanks for the information. And then I thought more about it, and I remembered where that image was. It was in the Museum of the Bongya Shahitya Parishad. And in 1969, when Kathy and I were living in Calcutta, I remembered that thieves one night broke in through the skylight of the Bongya Shahitya Parishad and stole three bronzes, one of which quite clearly was the museum, one from Boston. And so I wrote Jan Fontaine yet again to say, look, you've got a stolen image and you must return it. This time he did not acknowledge my letter. So I wrote him yet a fourth time to say, if you don't return this, I will write each of the trustees of the museum to say that you are harboring stolen property. Still no response, but about 3 months later, I received a brown envelope with clippings from two Boston newspapers, each of which showed Jan Fontaine, proud, and the director of the museum, who had also himself earlier smuggled out a Raphael painting from Italy, forced to return, handing over the bronze image to the ambassador from India. So at least, you know, I hope that gives you a sense that I feel very strongly that when something can be documented, it must be returned.
Yeah, thank you for the perspective. I was just listening to your talk. You somehow linked to usage of the language to the origin of these things.
But I was wondering whether you're able to match the origin of these languages, for example, the Kannada, when it has become started being used vis-a-vis the time periods which you talked about. Because I think the evolution of these languages would have been a little later part of this. When you were referring to the 5th, 6th centuries, I'm not sure whether these languages, I'm just asking as a naive to you, that whether you would be able to match this origin, then your argument would become more stronger, be it Odisha or Kannada. Or see, though there is a known that Tamil language has got much more origin to a longer time, but I'm not sure about the other languages.
Nor am I. So I'm not going to be a great deal of help in responding. I know Sanskrit, but I don't know any Dravidian language at all. I cannot speak a word of Tamil or Kannada or Malayalam or Telugu. So I have to rely on the expertise of others. And I have written and been in correspondence with several historians from South India who know the languages well. And they assure me, absolutely assure me, that Kannada, that old Kannada, used, for example, in the inscriptions of Badami, is absolutely clearly distinct from contemporary language in Tamil Nadu. I just have to accept that, especially when it comes identically from several of my historian colleagues. Now, I will admit, a majority does not necessarily make it right. But these are serious scholars. I see no reason to doubt their authority and their expertise.
I just wanted to mention that there is one panel in Konark Temple which shows the giraffe as an animal.
I don't know that one, and I haven't seen it, and I've been... You have, okay.
And this has been noted, and people have sort of constructed fiction, novel on it, and so on and so forth. There are different arguments proposed. How did the artist come to imagine what a giraffe was like, unless that information was conveyed to him, or he went to Africa, or something like that?
I see.
So, but basically, it looks as if there was a lot of maritime activity from Orissa, that part of Orissa, although it may not be very significant in terms of trade. There was there are different markers like this.
Sure. Look, as for the giraffe or any exotic animal, it doesn't really surprise me. I see two possibilities. Gifting from between two emperors was often in the form not just of jewels and gold and other things, but exotic animals were often made gifts. You know, for example, the gift to Jahangir of the zebra, which was a major curiosity. So one possibility is that an actual giraffe was given to one of the Orissan kings. The other possibility, however, is that a drawing or painting of a giraffe was sent, and that in itself was such an extraordinary curiosity that it was rendered then in sculpture. We have just such an example of a giraffe, which is, after all, an extraordinary animal. I've seen several in the wild at one place in Africa, and quite recently, and I must say, looking at those animals was itself an awesome, an awe-ing experience. So I could imagine somebody looking at a painting or drawing of a giraffe and copying it. And we do have at least one such example that I can think of a giraffe in a drawing that was then copied in another drawing and sent onward to China, where it was treated as, again, an absolute spectacle in the royal court.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor, for excellent talk.
Thank you all very much for your kind being here.
Thank you very much for this wonderful talk, and I thank Director for chairing this talk as a token of our appreciation and a mark of the event. I request our director to present a souvenir to you. Professor. On behalf of director, staff, and students, and the large NIAS family, I thank Professor Frederick Asher for delivering this wonderful talk today. I thank all of you for being here and making this discussion really lively. Thank you very much.